I don't have to be like official like I was at graduation. I can say whatever I want here. We get to honor three young men. And one of the things I love about the opportunities I have to be bivocational is to see them in church, but also to see them as they go through school. Two of these were in my class, and one of them I had the opportunity of being with at school. And the beautiful thing is this. I get to see that they're the same people here that they are out there, or out there that they are here. So these are three fine, amazing young men. The first one we're going to honor this morning is Mr. Clayton Shiver. He really is excited about this right now. Clayton Shiver graduated from Liberty University. What? I like the music. With a degree in business administration. He is currently a staff sergeant serving in the United States Air Force, where he is a boom operator. Thank you for your service. His plans are to be commissioned as an officer and become a pilot. Clayton was one of mine at Tomlin. I've said this before, and you've probably heard this around. He was truly a test taker. His mom, that's the first time I really got to meet Miss Jennifer Shiver and Greg, but dealt with Jennifer more than I did Greg. And he would say when I'd make those phone calls, "Miss Shiver, he's failing." "Well, don't worry, wait until he takes a test." At first I was saying, that's impossible. He would ace every single test I had. So Clayton became one of mine that sat near me, didn't do much in class, but he always passed the test. And the truth is, you turned out to be a fine young man. So thank you for all you've done. Can we get a photo? Any photo? Come on, throw that, Clayton. Just to make it more grueling, you have to do this. Can y'all just airbrush this animal here or something like that? Come on, Greg, get that phone, that big photo. Clayton's about to pass out. He locked his knees. Congratulations, and thank you. I don't know why you went back, because remaining in the family is our second graduate we get to honor this morning. This is Samuel Shiver. Look at that picture. We love him. Call him Sammy. He is a graduate of Strawberry Crest High School. He was a four-year member of the Crest football team during his senior year. His team beat Plant City High School. He is. He's so proud of that. Sammy loves music. There he is. Sammy loves music. I can surely tell each and every one of you, if you've met him, he has an old soul. He serves in his church, where he does an amazing job of turning Pastor Randy's slides. Amen. Pastor Randy thanks him very, 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 very much. He plans to attend HCC in the fall. I am prophesying that he'll eventually end up going to seminary, where he will be a pastor and a minister, and I will get to attend his church. This is Mr. Samuel Shiver.
Family.
I won't tell her.
I haven't spent $1,500 on pictures already.
These are actual there you go.
Awesome.
Thank you. Samuel Shiver. Last.
Hi.
We're working on props here. Thank you for being patient with us. Last but certainly not least, come on, Logan, come up here, is Mr. William Taylor Teeden V. I have to say, right now, my speaker didn't graduate. Show them the front. So there. They have these things at our church called, at Baccalaureate, called cardboard testimonies. This is his testimony. He says, "I was not a level 3 reader. until 10th grade. I could not get into STEM in middle school, but turn it around there, Logan. He is now a graduate with a 5.3 GPA, 600 hours, AP calculus, and $40,000 in scholarship for college. That will help at all. Taylor, as he's known by, is a graduate of the Plant City High School. He is a member of too many organizations for me to even try to enlist. His list up here has over 6,000, is what I put there, just a hyperbole. 6,000 service hours. He's constantly serving. Is a superstar on the basketball court. That's all because of great coaching. Was the district golfer of the year his senior year this past year. He was our scholar athlete, male scholar athlete for our school. Is an all-around great guy. He plans to attend Southeastern in the fall and plans to one day be the head basketball coach at Plant City High School.
That's cool.
I made that part up. It actually says that. I made that up right there. If you ever get to know Taylor, he actually has a true heart of a champion. One day, if you get a chance, pull him aside and ask him what a heart of a champion's about. He can give you a life testimony that is life-changing. Next slide, please. There he is.
Aww.
Right there. On the court. I believe that's Mr. Aguero at the door. Isn't that Mr. Aguero right there by the door? There he is in both of his things. Just a wonderful, wonderful young man. This is Mr. Taylor T.
Family.
He's good to these photos. He's only had 100 and something over the last good weeks.
I didn't take any at graduation.
And you're in the
totally forgot something.
Oh, no, that smile is so gorgeous.
Amen. Road. You can tell from my military background, I always like to make acronyms or things to remember things by. That song is one of my brother's favorite songs. And if you think about it, the desert road, every one of us is on a road. The Talking Heads said it really, really well, on a road to nowhere. But we're on this road. If you ever get a chance, my media specialist over there, if you ever get a chance to read the book, Pilgrim's Progress, and you look, it's all about traveling this road that we call life. And who are walking it with, and how we're walking it, and where are we going? My favorite poet all time said, two roads diverge in a yellow wood, and anyone traveling along, I stood. And then you look at that poem and you think about it, we have choices. We have roads ahead of us. Not any one of you, and I will say this to you, are on a dead-end road. A lot of times you feel like you're on a dead-end road. You're like, oh, it's going nowhere. No, you're going somewhere.
Amen.
Unfortunately, sometimes we let others take us places where we didn't want to go. We go down the road and we're not really sure, so we just follow along the group beside us or in front of us, and we let life just kind of dictate where we're going. I need to remind you guys, three of them are graduating today. Every one of you is in a place or a time in your life where the road is ahead of you. We should stop looking backwards and start looking forward. I always thought it was really interesting. You think about looking backwards. Fighter pilots, F-16 pilots, one of the things that they always argued about was they didn't have rear view mirrors in their planes. They only looked forward. Because why? The enemy's in front of them. You're only flying forward. It took the Israelis. They actually added rear view mirrors in theirs when I visited them. But the focus is, as you're flying along, you need to know what's in front of you. So I'm going to give a little charge to my graduates, but I think it's something we all can use, and it's road. R-O-A-D. Not retired on active duty, like we used to say in the military. But a simple acronym that you can remember, and hopefully a charge for your life. The R means to remember. Remember that what you were taught from your childhood from the Holy Scrolls, which can impart to you wisdom to experience everlasting life through the faith of Jesus the Anointed One. We have, for some reason, highlighted a really, really bad situation in society. We understand the scripture that says, raise them so they won't depart from what they've known. We give some type of clause or some type of free gift to those, grace, let's use that word, to people who are coming out of the church, and all of a sudden they get to be in their 20s or something, and they say, let them experience their freedom. No, I want you to remember where you are and where your parents brought you. I want you to remember what Jesus Christ Himself has done. I want you to remember Scripture. I know when I was not making the right decisions, I remembered those things. And it would at times, and I'm going to be honest with you, it would torment you. Because you knew you weren't doing the right things. You need to remember this day. You need to remember that your graduation was covered in prayer. That your family and your support group was there in church. Don't forget those things. I don't want you to think back like, well, my parents had a drug problem. They drug me to church every Sunday. I want you to remember that God, the sovereign creator of all things, provided everything for you and will continue to do that. You need to trust in Him through faith. I will give you something that I wish somebody would have said to me. Faith doesn't get easier. We, for some reason, believe that the moment that we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, our faith is at its highest point because we walked down the aisle, we were embarrassed, and we confessed before man that, and then to the Father, and all of a sudden we're saved, and we believe that was our highest point in our faith. It's going to get tougher. I want you to remember as you go upon this road that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit wants to give you wisdom. He wants to give you life that is guided through and not just waiting to your eternal life. For some of us are so focused on, I'm just going to do whatever I can. At the last minute, I will call a truce. I will scream out to Him in my last breath. And guess what? I get everlasting life. That's not wrong. That's just not the way we should go through life. Not many of you driving cars or going through your life wait till the moment right before the day you're going to get sick, because next week I'm going to get sick, so on this day I will buy my insurance. It doesn't work that way. I think it's pretty cool that insurance companies won't insure you with a pre-existing, but yet we want God to do that. So please remember, God so loved you that He gave His only begotten Son. It also says, the second letter there is O. Obey. Oh no. I've graduated. I don't have teachers I have to obey anymore. I don't have school rules to obey anymore. I'm now going to be close to 18. Some of you are, Clayton's over 18, obviously, and you're looking at your age and you're like, I don't have to obey my parents anymore. I was a grown man when I moved back into my house before I went in the military. And I still obey the rules of my parents. Maybe not very well, but I was trying to obey their rules. This was not given to us by a prophet. This was given to us by the Son of God. And he said, if anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. We always think of, or quite often we think of, we have to obey him so that we get something out of it. As children, we learn that lesson. Well, if I'm really good and I obey my parents, I will get something out of this. I can remember sitting there when Byron was being disobedient. It was so easy for me to be, yes, ma'am, yes, sir. Why? Because I'm not going to get in trouble. Think about it the opposite way. Don't obey him for what you're going to get. Obey him for what he's already done.
Amen.
That's really good.
Yeah. Obey my teaching. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. We, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Father, sovereign over all creation. Son, who paid the price for you, and the Holy Spirit that wants to guide you and lead you from the mistakes that you're going to make. I love this song, and I quote it all the time, trust and obey, for there's no other way. I wish we got the obedient part. We have law enforcement officers that when you're disobedient, they come and get you, and there's consequences. I'm going to tell you something that was sad to learn as I grew older and older. You're always going to have somebody over you that you're going to have to obey. I'm going to own my own company. Well, you see how that works with the IRS. I'm going to be out on my own. I won't pay the... No, you're going to always have somebody that you have to be accountable to.
Yes, that's true.
So why not be accountable to the one that loved you first?
Yes.
Why not be accountable to the one who paid a price that you don't ever have to worry about? None of you will ever have to go to the cross for anyone else because he's already done that for everyone.
Amen.
Obedient is one of the life lessons I learned in the military. Because they really push it down your throat. Be obedient. In basic training, I was going to be the most obedient military person there. I was a little bit older. I was 22 or 23 when I went in the military. All the kids were 18 around me. And they were acting like 18-year-olds. And I'm like, no, I'm going to be super, super obedient. So obedient that it made the drill sergeant mad. And he said, you know what, Humphrey? You're too obedient. So you don't do the mistakes. You don't do the wrong things. So you should not have to be in trouble. I was like, yes. So your battle buddy, Robbie Warren, who's only 18 years old, whenever he messes up, you will do his push-ups. Oh, Lord. It's hard to have to pay for what other people do. I was miserable having to pay for something I didn't do, but he was doing the wrong thing. And all of a sudden, as I grew older, I realized Jesus paid for all the things that I've done wrong.
Amen.
Why don't you obey him? A, align. You've heard this scripture before. It's a nugget scripture we learn in church. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed. I saw the Transformer little thing last night at the movies. Can't wait. Transformed by the what? Renewing of your mind.
Thank you, Jesus.
Then you'll be able to test and prove what God's will is. Good, pleasing, and perfect will. The renewing of your mind. Young people, they're going to constantly try to mold your mind to what benefits them.
Yep.
We have so many different ways. I got to talk to a young person recently, and you think about, they've all of a sudden, they become, in this word, I think we use it in the wrong context, enlightened. You're going to go off to college and they're going to teach you things and you're going to go, I never heard of such a thing. You mean I can walk around everywhere with no shoes and just hit a tambourine? They'll teach you that. I learned that in Florida.
That was a long time ago, too.
Yeah, and I think they don't have shoes on yet. I really don't. Transformed by the renewing of your mind. That means to turn to him and put your mind in alignment with Christ. Daily. Well, I'm going to do it in the morning. I promise you. It's like that tire or that car that you can never get in alignment. They'll align it, and all of a sudden, by the end of the day, it's out of alignment. Because guess what's going to happen? You're going to get aligned with Christ, and then you're going to hit bumps along the way, and it's going to throw your thing out of alignment. You have to get it realigned. You ever wonder why you have to get your car realigned? Because if you don't, you're going to steer off the road. You're going to crash and burn and die. Realign with his mindset. And guess what? He doesn't mind you realigning with his mind. When we have him, we put on the mind of Christ, we all of a sudden, we understand his good, pleasing, and perfect will for our lives. Let me take something off of your shoulders right now, graduates, young people, anybody that's going through life changes or whatever. You're going to make bad decisions. I am not going to stand before you and say that if every morning you clap your hands together and you kneel before your bed and you ask for God's will to be done in your life, that you're going to make the perfect decision. You're not. Circumstances are going to catch you off guard. You're going to go through something that you don't never heard of before. They're going to bring something against you that you never even expected, and you're going to just go with what you know best. If you remember the first letters before the A, if you're obedient and remember everything that God's taught you up until this point, hopefully you'll make the best decision. But it's not always a good decision. Be in line with what Christ has for your life. The last letter is D. You have to make a decision. You have to decide. No longer can your parents' faithfulness to service in church, no longer can your parents telling you about Jesus be enough. You have to make a decision. They always laugh and they tell stories about PKs, preacher's kids, pastor's kids. I have a pretty amazing PK who has followed in line with what God wants for his life, I believe. Is willing to speak on scripture at any time, even to me and Kimberly.
Yes.
When we're not doing right, he'll correct us. Whoever serves me must follow me. And where I am, my servant will also be. My father will honor the one who serves me. Listen.
That's really good.
There was no magical, mystical, spiritual power that caused those fishermen to follow Jesus. It doesn't tell us in scripture that when he says, hey, will you follow me, that all of a sudden he was doing a Jedi mind trick. He didn't have the Spock locked into their heads and go, I'm going to plant this. He wasn't the little lady, the Oriental lady or Asian lady on Guardians of the Galaxy that could persuade you and touch your mind. God, through his son Jesus Christ, just said, will you follow me? They had a decision to make. Truth of it is, we only read in scripture what we know because it's purpose for us. We don't know if there were other guys out there who went, that guy's a lunatic. I'm not going to follow him. For many of you, you have to make a grown-up decision now. Some of you are thinking, and this is where I thought, well, I was about 12 when I accepted Jesus Christ. I've got this. I'm covered. I didn't make good decisions through high school and through college and then when I got into the military. It wasn't until I got married that all of a sudden I had to felt like the decisions impacted somebody more than just me. All of a sudden I felt like, man, now I've got a wife and a son who rely upon the decisions I'm going to make. It's sad that I didn't see and understand that I'm as important to Jesus Christ and God the Father as they are. Why didn't I make the decision for myself sooner? You're going to be faced with decisions that you're going to have to make. You may be able to pick up and call mom and dad and say, hey, I'm dealing with this. They're going to be there. I want you to know, as a family member of One Accord Church, you can always call me. But I'm going to tell you at the end of the day, you have to make the decision. Miss Jennifer, who does therapy and guidance and counseling as an assistant or AP at the high school, I find myself a lot of time counseling students. And you can see the fear in their face when they're like, just make a decision. And I can do that. Growing up, I always made a decision where we were going to eat dinner on Friday night. I made the decision. Well, I was a fat kid. But I made the decision. They want someone else to make the decision. I want you to understand and own up. Your decisions affect you. So you should make them. Your parents, prayerfully, will love you through bad decisions. God loves you through bad decisions.
Thank you, Jesus.
All he's asking you to do is to choose him first. and everything else will fall in line. Remember, obey, align yourself with Christ, and decide to follow Him. I wanted a great quote to walk out of here on. Those who walk with God always reach their destination.
That's good.
You would think that would be somebody spiritual. It was Henry Ford. Those who walk with God always reach their destination. The irony in that is I believe that Henry Ford didn't want you to walk anymore. He wanted you to buy a car and drive. But he understood that if you walk with God, you will always reach your destination. I'm not one to think that destination is your eternal life with Him in heaven. That's a great destination. But I want you all to be fruitful and do amazing things here on this earth. I want you to reach destinations that you didn't think were possible. I want Clayton to be a pilot. I want to be able to see him come here in his flight suit. I want to be able to one day preach a sermon and do something crazy and have a flyby right in the middle of the church. And the Lord said, and flies by. I do believe in all my heart that Sammy will be in ministry one day. He loves people like nobody else. He has a love for God like nobody else. He has a presence that makes people look and listen, because when he walks in a room, he's not a small, diminutive guy. He's a guy that carries the room. I can't wait to hear his band play one day when he's out there jamming on the Christian radio or whatever he wants to do. I believe he has greatness ahead of him, and I can't wait to see him grow in his ministry. Taylor, I've only got to meet this guy for a few years now, and I'm telling you, as much as I love my son and the story of his life that I believe God spared and was miraculous, Taylor, you have the same thing in your heart, and you know that. More than the rest of us know that. They don't understand where your heart's been, what it's been through, and how much it's grown physically and spiritually. So I pray blessings over you, and know, like your daddy, you're going to be a great encourager to a lot of people. You're going to go off to college, and you're not going to be the freshman who nobody listens to. You're going to lead from the very beginning. And I know that's who you are. I know that's who God has planned you to be. So go out and do great and wonderful things. And please come back and coach for me one day. That would be great. I'll hire you. I'll fire your dad for you. I will do that. Billy's like, why am I getting you fired? What am I doing? I believe there's greatness there. Guys, this is an amazing graduating class. Will you please stand with us if you're a graduate today? Have our graduates stand. Give them, there's three of you guys, stand one more time, Clayton. We got this. Our graduates. Take a seat, guys. It's not all about y'all. Have a seat there. God, it's going to make it all about y'all. We're going to close this service out. We've got a couple of announcements. Do you realize that Tuesday night we have men's Bible study, not women's. Men's only. Correct, Isabel?